Hello everyone. Welcome to the class on antimicrobial resistance with me, Sanjay Dekhrit. Let us have a look at the contents that we'll be discussing today. We'll be basically dealing with what is AMR, why is it a problem, the discovery of antibiotics versus resistance. We'll talk typically about resistance, susceptibility of microbes versus the resistance. Then we'll talk about the notorious escape pathogens. We'll also talk about Staph aureus, which has been labeled as the superbug. We'll be talking about the mechanisms of resistance. Then we'll also talk about the genetic alterations like mutation, conjugation, and transduction that are known to confer resistance. And we'll be talking about the prevention of AMR at the end. Okay. AMR. Antimicrobial resistance basically threatens the effective prevention and treatment of ever-increasing range of infections that is caused by various microbes like bacteria, parasites, viruses, and fungi. AMR is an increasingly serious threat to global public health and requires actions against all government sectors and society. Why is it a problem? Because antibiotic-resistant infections, they are difficult to cure and result in increased expenses. As a result of longer duration of illness, additional tests that are required, and because they require more expensive drugs in the treatment. Okay, so what is antimicrobial resistance? Antimicrobial resistance happens when microbes such as bacteria, fungi, and viruses, they change when they are exposed to antimicrobial drugs, such as antibiotics, antifungals, antivirals, antimalarials, and helminths. Microorganisms, they develop antimicrobial resistance and sometimes they are referred to as superbugs. As a result, the medicines become ineffective and the infections persist in the body, increasing the risk of spread to others. Typically, when a person visits hospitals, then hospitals are known to harbor relatively resistant kind of bugs, in that there are many patients who have got multiple infections, right? So nosocomial infections are generally caused by relatively resistant kind of microbes, and then treating the resistant nosocomial infections leads to increased expenses in the patients, and even those kind of infections are difficult to treat. Without effective antimicrobials for the prevention and treatment of infections, the medical procedures which are being done easily now would be difficult, like organ transplantation, cancer chemotherapy, diabetes management, major surgery. They all become a difficult task. Okay. Let us have a look at the history of resistance. This is a chart which shows the discovery of the antibiotics versus when was the resistance identified, right? In case of penicillin, the first antibiotic that was discovered. It was discovered in 1928, but then its clinical use by Harvey and Fleury and Chain, it began only in 1940. But following a year after its use itself, in 1941, there was a case of resistance. Similarly, sulfonamides, which was discovered in 1932, it saw its resistance cases emerging in 1942. You can have a look. It does not take relatively long time for resistance to develop. This is the basic idea. And when Alexander Fleming was awarded the Nobel Prize for discovery of penicillin back in 1945, he said that if we don't use antibiotics prudently, then we are sure to stumble across the resistance of microbes. In the theory postulated by Darwin, he says that there is the survival of the fittest. So what happens with microbes is also the microbes tend to mutate or tend to change in order to survive in the changing condition. To be effective, an antibiotic must reach the target organism and bind to it, and resistance can happen as a result of failure either to reach the target, or as a result of inactivation of the drug, or alteration of the target, or the efflux of the drugs. Okay, You can have a look at the picture that is presented out here. Here you see that a bunch of bacteria, including the resistant variety, is present, right? And when they are treated with antibiotics, most of the bacteria normally die. However, the resistant bacteria, they start to multiply and become more common. Eventually, the entire infection evolves into a resistant strain. And there may be various ways in which bacteria produce resistance, right? One is bacteria produces enzymes at or within the cell surface that inactivate the drug. Another could be bacteria possessing impermeable cell membrane that prevent the influx of the drug. Another, the transport mechanism of certain drug that is energy dependent is not effective in anaerobic environment. And antibiotics being organic acids, penetration is pH dependent. Resistance may be acquired by mutation and passed vertically by selection to daughter cells. However, there is more common mechanisms which involve horizontal transfer of resistance, like the determinant from donor cell and often to another bacterial species by transformation, transduction, and conjugation. The horizontal transfer can be rapidly disseminated by clonal spread of resistant strain itself and genetic exchange between the resistant and further susceptible strains. Okay, let us talk about susceptibility versus resistance. The success of any therapy depends upon achieving concentration of antibiotic at the site of infection, which is enough to inhibit the bacterial growth. If the host defenses are maximally effective, then bacteriostatic agents can be used which slow the protein synthesis or prevent the bacterial division. However, if the host defenses are impaired, then bactericidal agents are used and complete antibiotic mediated killing is necessary. However, this is considered not practically true in clinics, right? And there are instances where bacteriostatic agents have been used in case of impaired host defense systems. We did talk about this when we were talking about bacteriostatic agents and bactericidal agents. Okay, normally a dose of the drug that is sufficient to produce the intended effect, that is either inhibit or kill the microorganism, is used. However, the concentration of the drug that is used must be below that is toxic to the human cells. And so if this can be achieved, then the microorganism is susceptible to the antibiotic. But if the effective concentration is higher and can cause even toxicity to the human cells, then we call the microorganism to be resistant. When the ratio of toxic to therapeutic concentration is very low, the agents become difficult to use. The concentration in the certain compartments like vitreous fluid, cerebrospinal fluid, it is much lower than that in plasma. Therefore, drugs can be only marginally effective or ineffective, even those in vitro test states sensitive. Conversely, if a drug in urine is present in much higher concentration than in plasma, then even the resistant agents can be effective in limiting the infection or creating the infection of urinary tract. Okay, let us have a look at the various escape pathogens. Escape pathogens are found to be one of the most notorious pathogens in terms of resistance, right? Escape stands for Enterococcus faecium, Staph aureus, Klebsiella pneumoniae, Acinetobacter baumannii, Pseudomonas aeruginosa, and Enterobacteriaceae. These pathogens are so notorious that in 2017, WHO called for need of new antibiotics to treat some of the pathogens listed here in escape pathogens. Okay, let us have a look at the rise of the Staph aureus as superbug. The picture here shows the discovery of various agents that were used to treat Staph aureus at different times. And then when did the resistance to those agents develop in Staph aureus? we see that penicillin was discovered somewhere in 1940. Penicillin began to be clinically used in 1940-41, right? However, by mid-1940s, there was already resistance to penicillin. Similarly, it went to pandemic level somewhere in 1952-53. Vancomycin and methicillin, they were discovered in 1950s. And again, by 1962 or so, there was already resistance to methicillin. So this shows that the resistance to different agents, they were seen quite quickly with Staph aureus, and thereby the labeling of this as superbug, in that it is very difficult to treat. Let us have a look at the resistance mechanisms to different antibiotics. As discussed earlier, the resistance mechanisms to different antibiotics can happen as a result of efflux of the antibiotics. Second, the impermeability to the antibiotics, they will not be able to enter itself. Third, even if they enter the target, they need to bind and attack may be modified. So target modification may be the third one. And the fourth one is the inactivation of the enzymes. If a drug acts by working on certain enzyme, then inactivation of the enzymes is going to confer resistance towards the antibiotics. So there are certain bacteria that cause efflux of the antibiotics, and then this system is going to cause resistance to certain antibiotics like chloroquinolones, aminoglycosides, tetracyclines, beta-lactams, and macrolides. Similarly, impermeability to antibiotics may be a problem with tetracyclines, trimethoprim, sulfonamides, and vancomycin. Likewise, the target modification can give a problem for chloroquinolones, rifampicin, vancomycin, penicillin, macrolides, and aminoglycosides. And the inactivation of the enzymes is a problem with beta-lactams, aminoglycosides, macrolides, and rifampicin. In the various mechanisms of resistance to antimicrobial agents, we saw that enzymatic inactivation is one of the mechanisms, right? And we said that beta-lactams, they are susceptible to enzymatic inactivation. The ability of the microbes to destroy or inactivate the antimicrobial agents can confer resistance to microorganisms like beta-lactamases. They are known to destroy many penicillins and cephalosporins. Here we see that the beta-lactamase, they break the beta-lactam ring in both the penicillin and cephalosporin. Modification of target sites. The microbes can resist to beta-lactams by alteration of the target site, that is the penicillin binding protein, the mutation of dihydrofolate reductase, which is less likely to lead to inhibition of organism, causes resistance to trimethoprim. Decreased accumulation. The antibiotics, first, they may be unable to gain access to the site of action, one, and another, they may be unable to retain a bactericidal or bacteriostatic concentration due to the presence of an efflux system that pumps the drug out. So the gram-negative bacteria, they possess a special membrane, lipopolysaccharide layer, and they decrease the penetrability of the antibiotics. This leads to decreased accumulation. Again, the antibiotic efflux pumps in gram-negative bacteria, they are known to cause the efflux of antibiotics, right? So multi-drug efflux pumps have been noted that traverse both the inner and outer membranes of the gram-negative bacteria. They help push the drug out of the system. These type of pumps, they are composed of minimum of three proteins and are energized by the protein force. The increased expression of these pumps is an important cause of antibiotic resistance. Okay, the resistance to antimicrobial agent, it can be intrinsic kind or it can be the acquired resistance. Intrinsic resistance is when it's a natural resistance existing on a chromosomal level. The gram-negative bacilli to basic penicillins, it is an intrinsic resistance. However, acquired resistance is something that is induced by microsomal agents, and it's more plasma-mediated, sometimes chromosome-mediated. Okay, now let us talk about the contributors to drug resistance. So far we said that humans, they are treated with different kind of drugs. So if the humans, they do not take the drugs as intended, then it can lead to drug resistance, in that subtherapeutic drug concentrations or drug concentrations below the minimum inhibitory concentration or minimal bactericidal concentration, it can give the bacteria a kind of opportunity to develop resistance, and resistance will develop to bacteria in them because of such conditions. However, it is not that the use of drugs in humans is the major factor. The use of drugs in animals and not in treating animals rather than in farming animals is the major contributor to drug resistance so far. So this was when the farmers found out that feeding animals antibiotic, it increased the lean meat in pigs. And even now in our country and many other countries, antibiotics, they are used to increase the meat in live animals and also to increase the milk production in dairy cows as well. Now let us have a look at the genetic alterations leading to drug resistance. Mutation. Specific genetic mutations are the molecular basis for resistance to streptomycin, quinolones and rifampicin. We see that in case of streptomycin, there is ribosomal mutation. In case of quinolones, there is DNA gyrase gene mutation. And in case of rifampicin, there is RNA polymerase gene mutation. The mutation to rifampicin is a single step mutation. E. coli and Staph aureus exposure to rifampicin, it results in highly resistant strains due to point mutation in RNA polymerase gene, causing the polymerase protein to no longer bind to the rifampicin. Okay. Second, transduction. The resistance that occurs when bacteriophage, which includes the bacterial DNA in its protein folds, it infects the bacteria. In doing so, some of the bacteria, they die. However, some other kind of bacteria, they take the bacterial DNA from the bacteriophage and include it in their own genome. In this way, they gain resistance to different antibacterial drugs. For example, Staph aureus develop resistance to penicillin by transduction. Some bacteriophages, they carry the plasmids that code for penicillinase, and then they can give this very plasmid to new bacteria, whereby the new bacteria also starts developing penicillinase and offers resistance to penicillin. Conjugation is another method that is important for single and multi-drug resistant development. In conjugation, what happens is there is a direct passage of resistance conferring DNA between bacteria, and this proceeds by the means of a bridge. Here, it is the pili that works as a bridge, right? The sex pili works as a bridge, and then it confers the bacterial resistance through plasmids. The genetic material transfer in conjugation requires two elements: the R-determinant plasmid, which codes for the resistance, and the resistance transfer factor plasmid, which contains the gene that is necessary for bacterial conjugation process. Most of the resistance in gram-negative bacteria is mediated by conjugation. So, as to prevention of resistance, there are certain things that ought to be considered. Do not use antimicrobial agents for a prolonged time unless necessary. For acute localized infections in otherwise healthy patients, symptom-determined shorter courses is recommended. Prefer rapidly acting and selective antimicrobial agents whenever possible. The broad spectrum agents should be used only when a specific one cannot be determined or is not suitable. Use combination of antimicrobial agents when a prolonged therapy is undertaken, like the case of tuberculosis. The infection by organisms notorious for developing resistance, like Staph aureus, E. coli, M. tuberculosis, Proteus, they must be treated intensively so that resistance is not developed in them. So, at last, let us conclude. In the past, the antibiotics, they have revolutionized the medicine and have saved millions of lives. Right? Presently, the increasing bacterial resistance and and failing to produce new antibiotics. This is causing the reduction in the efficacy of antibiotics. In the future, we need a continuous supply of new antibiotics if we are to win the war against resistant bacteria. CDC in USA, they have been urging the doctors to improve antibiotic prescribing in that the new antibiotics in the pipeline are very, very less and the cases of emergence of resistance is very high. CDC here stands for Center for Disease Control. Okay, this is a picture that I got which shows the different classes of antibiotics that are effective against different group of different kind of bacteria. Gram-positive and gram-positive, gram-negative, and both. This was again a chart that I came across online. Maybe this sums up a lot many things as to which drug can be used in which kind of infections. Okay, I suggest you guys to make charts like this on your own so that it becomes easy for you guys to study at the last minute. Thank you. That's all for today. Thank you. Everyone, have a good day.